In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. Beloved brothers and sisters, once again, it is a great privilege and pleasure to have this opportunity to share with you some of the words and guidance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I want to say a very special thank you to all of the family members of the visitors and followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who, upon their children's request, came to visit this humble building today. The reason I asked those who have declared themselves to be followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad to invite the members of their family, whether their family members are Christian or agnostic or whatever your particular religious persuasion or philosophical understanding may be, that we need to sit down together as a family. And if you think a family member of yours has gone astray by coming here, and you feel that you are secure in that which God has blessed you with, then your visit here will not take you away from what you presently think and feel and believe, but perhaps it may help you to understand, not from the media, but from the man himself, what he's all about, that maybe there may be a point of equitable agreement between you and your family members, that you may not persecute each other because you've made a change in your life, but that you may understand one another and grow tighter in the bond of love. So today, before I begin our subject, it came over the news on the closing day of the old year that a Japanese pilot flying a jumbo cargo jet plane from Tokyo over the Arctic, I believe, and he saw a strange light, small circular planes following his plane. They followed him for 400 miles, which meant that he had these strange objects in his view for at least 50 minutes, at least. If he were going a little over 500 miles an hour, I would assume a jumbo jet, that he had what he saw in view for approximately 50 minutes, which is a long time to look at something and for something to be looking at you. Now, he noticed the silhouette of a very huge object. Now, remember, he's in the sky. I would imagine that he was between 30 and 40,000 feet in the air, approximately 5 miles up. So whatever he saw 5 miles up, looking out of the window of his cockpit, was also up at a considerable height. Mind you, he said it was a very huge object that appeared to be the size of 2 aircraft carriers. Now, if you've ever seen an aircraft carrier, then you know an aircraft carrier is capable of having on board it up to 7,000 passengers. With, of course, a huge number of airplanes. But now this was not the size of one aircraft carrier. Seeing something that huge in the sky would frighten me, I'm sure. Frighten you too. But something the size of two aircraft carriers. And an aircraft carrier of the huge type could be over 300 yards long, 900 feet to 1,200 feet in length. Well, I can understand the pilot was shook. And for the first time, the FAA, the Federal Aeronautics, I think, Aviation Administration, said that they took note of this object on their radar screens. This man made a picture of it, and he put the jumbo jet near it to give you some idea of the relative size of this object that he saw in comparison to the huge jumbo jet, the biggest thing that white folks make. And the jumbo jet looked like it could fit in this other plane over 150 times. Now let us stop a moment. As black people, we are very suspicious of black people. And whenever a teacher arises from among our own ranks telling us something that you did not learn from white folks, we are automatically suspicious of that person and we believe they have made it up. As much as black people have suffered and are still suffering, and as much as you go to church and talk about God and talk about Jesus and talk about Moses, you are very, very hypocritical in your praise of God and in your talk of the prophets, for evidently, deep down in your own being, you really don't believe that a man, Jesus, ever existed. And listen, I'm saying deep down in your being. I know what you say out of your mouth and what's in your conscious mind, but I want to show you your actions to show that underneath all your talk, you are absolutely a hypocrite under it. When it comes to putting it to the test, you really don't have any confidence that God is really real. Wait a minute now. I know I'm upsetting you. And I invited you here to have a good time. But I will never fail to tell the truth to give you a good time. It is better that you be hurt and helped than to be soothed and hurt later. And there are too many preachers that preach to soothe you, never to really help you, because to help you is to hurt you because of your ignorance and your failure to respect yourself and to really love God as we should. I'm coming right back to something that I said, and I'm going to prove my point. You talk this God talk. You talk this Moses, Jesus, Abraham talk. But under you, there's disbelief.
Well, how can you say that, Minister Farrakhan? You say you believe, listen, that Jehovah gave Moses to Israel. You say you believe that Moses stood up against Pharaoh and with the power of a rod given to him by Jehovah, he caused the Red Sea to open and part. And the children of Israel went through and established a new nation under the guidance of God. You say you believe that. You read about Ezekiel. You read about Isaiah. You read about Joshua. You read about Elijah and Elisha and all the old prophets, and you read on for the work of those great worthies of God. And when it comes to Jesus, when his name is mentioned, a huge clamor arises in the church. Just the mention of his name throws people into shakes and whatnot. But now look at your condition and mine and ours and the condition of America and the condition of the world. With all your love for God and love for Jesus and belief in the prophets, you are in need right now of deliverance. Yes, talk back to me. Yes, you're poor, ragged, hungry, naked, out of doors, and oppressed. No jobs in an economy that is falling apart. Your homes are wrecked with division and hatred among family members, where children are killing each other, parents killing the children, and the children killing their parents. You are looking at your sons and your daughters, and the daughters and the sons are looking at their parents, snorting cocaine, spending valuable money, buying crack, saying you believe in God, but your hope is in the lottery. You believe in God, but give me the number and tell me your dream. You believe that God will make a way, but he'll make a way for you through something that he himself condemns, which is gambling. I want to reason with you. Your children look up and see mommy and daddy snorting coke, blowing reefer smoke in their faces. They see your condition degenerating from day to day or week to week, from month to month. And they see, as Brother Akbar quoted, the rise of a rabid racism that we thought with the civil rights movement and the death of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. that we had conquered the old days of the past. But now the old days are back again and coming back stronger, because white folk never got rid of their hatred of black people just because they didn't lynch us as they used to. Or they allowed us to come into their hotels and motels and restaurants, and we could go to the toilet on the highway as we travel. So that lulled you to sleep and made you think you were living in the promised land. But right where you work, they tolerate you. Even though we have a black mayor working hard in the city of Chicago, they tolerate him. They tolerate blacks in positions of power, but they wish they could wreck it and return it to the old days. They want to make Chicago a plantation. They want to make America the old America. The old America where the Indians were subdued, where the blacks are nothing but servants that are not needed anymore. You used to be the porters, You used to be the ones to do the dirty work. Today, they don't even have you portering anymore, dirty working anymore. That's given to foreigners. All you can do is be all you can be and join the armed forces. There's plenty of room there for you to send your sons and your daughters to fight for a country that has not given us justice one day since our fathers were in this country. We have eyes, but we cannot see. We have ears, but we are deaf to the truth. And our tongue, even when we know the truth, is stilled by fear of consequences. So we don't speak even what we know. We hush up our children when they seem to be bold and somewhat radical, not understanding that our children are from us, but not like us. They are born from your loins and from your womb to make a brighter day. But since you don't have the guidance to give them, to help them on the way to a brighter day, they are turning now to destruction. And you are looking at this with churches on every corner and a bar in the middle of every block. Where there's a church, there's a bar. Where there's a bar, there's drugs and dope and prostitution right next door to the church. The church has no effect except on those on the inside. And those on the inside are so holy now. They are so saved that they don't think about the unsaved. So they go to church every Sunday to sing some more, to moan some more, to holler and scream some more, and to give some more money. But they never try to bring other souls that need saving. So while you are hollering about being saved, your daughter is becoming a prostitute. Your son is becoming a drug addict. Your nephew has become a homosexual. And all around you, your world is falling down. And all you can clamor is that God exists, but where is he? Where is he? I know he exists. But to know that God exists is one thing. But to make him real in your life, that's another thing entirely. We need somebody. And if you can believe that Jehovah sent Moses to the children of Israel, and there was only 600,000 of them in bondage, and I never read in the scripture where Pharaoh hung the Israelites, castrated them. I never read of police brutality in any of the accounts of the Israelites. They were just put under hard taskmasters, which you know plenty about. But you've suffered what the children of Israel have suffered, and then some. And it's not 600,000 of you. There's over 30 million of us growing every day, suffering every day, in need of deliverance every day. Now, if God sent a man to deliver Israel, is his arm too short that it can't save us today? But you believe that Moses came. But you don't believe that God has the power to raise one from your midst and empower him to deliver you as he raised and empowered Moses to deliver Israel? Or do you think that's old poppycock stuff that we can look back on, but that will never happen today? if you got eyes and you can't see, yet you in the church. You got ears and you can't hear. You got a tongue, but you won't speak. You got a hand, but your hands are withered. They don't do no work for your black self. You got feet, but they won't walk. You got paralysis, and you lay and you sit at the rich man's gate like Lazarus, begging for the crumbs that fall from the rich man's table. But Lazarus met a Jesus. Who have you met? You say you know Jesus, but you're still sitting and you're still begging. You got eyes that can't see, but everybody that met Jesus, he changed their lives. He changed their direction.
All right, now.
He empowered them. You call it with the Holy Ghost. What is that? Is the Holy Ghost that? That comes over you only in church, causing you to holler and foam and run up and down the aisles? Is that the Holy Ghost? Talk back to me. When did you find Jesus frothing at the mouth and running up and down the shore of Galilee, talking about, I got it, I got it, I got it? We know Jesus had it by what he did with what he had. What do you have, and what are you doing with what you have? My objective, beloved, is only to help you to think and to reason with your faith in God. What I'm suggesting, dear beloved listeners, is that we have needed a deliverer. We have needed a Moses, a Jesus, and a Muhammad. We have needed all the prophets rolled up in one, because we're in all the conditions of their people rolled up into one. You've heard me say many times, if Noah could come back today, Noah would run back to God and say, hide me from the wickedness of the people. If Lot couldn't convert anybody, hardly in Sodom and Gomorrah, what time do you think Lot would have in Chicago today? And Chicago's only one of the Sodoms and Gomorrahs of America and the world. Lot would run back to God and say, I need power, God. If Moses came back today with his rod, and Pharaoh in Washington with all his high-powered technology,
yes, sir,
would look at Moses, and when Moses cast his rod, Pharaoh would come down with some magic that would send Moses running back to Jehovah. I need more juice.
Got to have some more juice.
Because the juice I used 4,000 years ago was able to subdue the Pharaoh of that day. But I need some high-powered juice today to remove the power of this wicked one today. Am I lying?
No, sir.
Nothing you got will work against white folks.
Go,
you got the ghost, but let the ghost help you against Reagan. Let the ghost help you against the Ku Klux Klan. Let the ghost help you against those that are snuffing out the life of your children. If the ghost can't help you and me overcome the condition that we are suffering from, we need to go back and tell God we need more ghosts, more juice, more spirit. We need the spirit that Jesus had. Ain't even got to my subject. That's what hurts. I'm just opening up. But my point is that we believe that God gave us the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
As he gave Moses, as he gave Daniel and Ezekiel and Noah and Lot, he gave us a man.
Gave us a man.
With guidance.
Yes,
and power. Over the power of Reagan and Pharaoh. And that man Elijah frightened you to death. But everyone that came near him, he changed our lives. And made us better men and better women. And you saw this with your eyes, but you disbelieved. Our own parents, when we came home and threw down the alcohol, threw down the drugs, stopped abusing you as our own mother, and started honoring you as our father, and became industrious, it was our own parents who said to us, I'd rather see you drunk than down there with those Muslims. Girl, what are you doing putting on that long dress? Looking like some old Aunt Jemima. I'd rather see you dead than in a long dress. But you love your grandmother. Your grandmother didn't wear no dress above her knees. And you said, well, that was yesterday. Yeah, but the morals of yesterday was much better than they are today. Would you not agree? Your grandmother that rocked you by her knee, whose hands held you and comforted you, that was a good grandmother. But she had high top shoes and long dress, and a man couldn't even see her ankles unless it was her husband. But today a man can see everything and don't even have to be your friend. Elijah Muhammad only went to the fourth grade of school.
Come on with it, man.
But he taught us what no college professor could teach us. And it was Elijah Muhammad 55 years ago who started teaching us about a plane in the sky that was made like a wheel. He said his teacher, a man, Master Farrakhan Muhammad, pointed out to him a dreadful looking plane in the sky, a half a mile by a half a mile. Built like the universe itself, it's circular and it holds within it 1,500 little wheel-like planes. When we heard Elijah say these things, many of us believed, and some of us disbelieved. But Reagan, a classified, bona fide liar, and all of the liars that have surrounded Reagan and Carter and Ford and all of the presidents. Since 1930, they have known that this plane exists.
Go ahead.
But why won't they tell the American people? It is because the white man does not want to admit that there is a technology in the world and a power in the world that makes his power look like that jumbo jet in comparison to that huge plane.
Go ahead.
He don't want to admit that he don't have what it takes to deal with that, what they call walnut-shaped object in the sky. Elijah Muhammad said to us that Ezekiel envisioned this. In the year 595 BC. And it's recorded right there in your Bible. Ezekiel looked up. It was a vision. And he saw a wheel in the middle of the air. It looked like a chariot of fire. a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. This is what Ezekiel saw, and he said in the wheel there was eyes in the wheel. When Elijah Muhammad left the scene, I didn't say died, I said left the scene. Because only finite beings die.
Yes, sir.
But divine men never die, because that which they lived for is eternal, and the word that they teach is gone beyond their physical frame.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
That's why Jesus lives. And Moses lives. And Abraham lives. And the righteous live. It is only the wicked who die. So when Elijah Muhammad left us, it was said that his teaching of a mother plane was a joke. It was false. It had other meanings. And it was explained away. The very heart of his teaching was ripped out. Because the heart of his teaching was and is that America's end as a power in the world has come, and that the Lord mighty in power is here judging America now. She's coming down. Not going up. I know you don't want to hear this. That's why I say you're hypocrites. Because when you pick up your Bible tells you of a day of judgment. You don't want to believe that you're living in it. The Bible tells you that a day would be coming that men and women and the children would be doing strange things. The Bible tells you that nation would rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there would be earthquakes and famine and pestilence. You talk about listening to the news, and the white boy that is your favorite meteorologist that you put confidence in, when he tells you it's going to rain, you get your raincoat. Because that white man know what he's talking about. But the white boy don't know how to predict no weather today. When he said one thing, another thing happens. Because another power is on scene today. And he can't read that power. I'm not angry. I'm not displeased with you. I just have to say what's on my heart. Your own disrespect of your blackness is what's going to get you killed. Because if God gives you a man, he's not going to send a white man to deliver you. He's going to send one of your own to deliver you. And if you have no love and no respect for your own, and don't think that God loves you enough to give you a man today that he gave others in the past, then your disbelief and your hatred of your black self will cause you to reject one that God sends you to fulfill the book. He came unto his own, but his own received him not. And the light shined in the darkness. But your hatred of yourself and your people and your disrespect and your distrust of yourself and your people was so strong, till when the light shined, even the darkness of your mind couldn't comprehend the power of the light that God had risen up among you. so many Muslim children who heard of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's teaching of the mother plane were frightened by it, and that fear kept them in the path until understanding could come. But when the talk of the judgment of America was made to look like a lie, then people ran away from Elijah Muhammad as though our commitment to him was only as long as we could see him. That's the way they were when Moses was here. They followed Moses as long as they could see him. But when Moses got out of sight, they say, out of sight, out of mind. Aaron, make us a god. As long as Jesus was running the miracle show. As long as Jesus could make a blind man see and raise a dead man to life and work some more miracles, maybe Doubting Thomas was hanging in tough, but he was still in doubt. Peter was hanging tough and talking tough, but Peter was not the man that everyone thought he should have been. All that tough talk was hiding a weak heart. So when the authorities came down on Jesus, Peter ran. When he saw him on the cross, he said, well, suddenly we saw you by the river Galilee. We saw you take the barley loaves and the fish and feed the multitude. We saw you turn the water into wine. If you're God's son, get yourself down off this cross. So I can believe in you again. I want to believe in you, Jesus. Your belief only means when the thing you believe in can show you what you want to see, what you need to see. But when they don't show you that, your belief goes. You like the whore. And as long as someone can show you the color of money, we can go to bed. But when your money run out, your pleasure run with it. You're a prostitutish kind of nation of people. You don't like my words, huh?
Yes, sir.
I don't give a damn. You want to call your children whores, huh? You want to call your little grandbabies whores because they're shacking up with men. But you whoring too. But your whoring is a sanctified whoring. You whoring after strange gods that can do you neither benefit nor harm. You bowing down to stones and statues. And people can come and show you false images and pictures and say, this is Jesus, and you got him hanging on your wall, and you never know what Jesus really looked like. So one whore ought to know another one, huh? You get your mouth off your children and start remembering your whoring ways. Because every time God deliver you, that's when you know he's God. But after he gets you safely where you prayed to go, that's when you begin setting up other gods beside him. I want to talk to you and me and us. Elijah Muhammad, I'm filled up this morning.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Because I was taken up on the wheel in a vision.
Go ahead.
September 1985. And I heard the voice of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad speaking to me from that wheel, on that wheel. And I described what I was shown.
Yes. Yes.
And his voice was as clear as my voice is to you, telling me what Reagan was about to do. And I went and revealed what he had shown me from the wheel, knowing that many of you would think I was crazy. But I don't care what you think. I got to do what God put on me to do. I can't try to be pleasing to you and please God. Sometimes to please God is to displease you. So since I ain't looking for my salvation from you, none of you, then if you are pleased by what I do or say, I thank God. But if you displease and what I say is right, I don't care. They want to paint me as some anti-Semitic devil while they read the book. You got Bibles in every room in your house. But a Bible can't save you if you won't open it up and read it. Jesus condemned the Jews. Was he anti-Semitic? Talk back to me. He called them devils in the plainest language. He said they were a generation of vipers, adulterers, seeking after a sign. Yes, it's in the Bible. But the thing is, when the Bible becomes real and somebody jumps off the page of the Bible and start living it, that's when you get frightened. You don't mind reading the Bible in your bathroom or reading it under the bed somewhere. But if a man come off the page and then say to a modern Pharaoh, let him go, and say to the modern Jew that you are the synagogue of Satan. If I say it, and I say it, what can they do against me but whatever Allah please? As the Jews instigated the Roman authorities against Jesus, they are instigating the fall of this government. And they are instigating the government to do something about me right away. I say, come on. I went to Libya and told Gaddafi what America was planning against him before it ever happened. I told him what they were going to bomb. Because it was shown to me. And I told him I got it from a wheel-like object. They don't want to tell you. But when the bombing started the first time, they looked up above and there was a bright, shining object over the Mediterranean that interfered with the communications on that highly sophisticated aircraft carrier. They had to send it back to Florida for repairs. They're not telling you this. There's a power today around us that's bigger than the power of white folks. I listened to the news. It said the planets were lining up. I said, that's strange. White folks got a lot of power, but all they can do is report what's happening with the planets. They can line up niggers. And they can line up preachers. And they can line up politicians, but they can't line up planets. But the planets were lined up. The sun, the moon, the earth. Few more planets. Your Bible said there will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars. Luke, Jesus talking.
Come on now.
What did you say, Jesus? He said, God told me. Is it Jesus talk?
That's what we're talking
about. Not me, not you. Jesus talk.
All right.
Because he said, whatever the Father revealed, that's what I speak. And he said, there will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars. Listen to him now. He said, the sea and the waves roaring.
Yeah.
I picked up my newspaper. My newspaper today is a witness bearer that there is no God but Allah, and that Muhammad most surely is his messenger. I read the newspaper and I say, you laughed at Elijah. You mocked him. You thought he didn't know what he was talking about. He said America would be curtailed on all her sides. She ain't got but three. The Atlantic, the Pacific, and the Gulf of Mexico. And if you go there and look, houses, the beach is eroding. People that you envied yesterday that bought property on the beach, built their homes almost in the water, now their homes are gone. And they're gone too. And over a 6-state area, they were told, move inland quick, because the sea and the waves are roaring. What you're roaring about? It said men's hearts failing them with fear for what they see coming upon the earth. Read it and weep, Reagan. Read it and weep, you infidels. Read it and weep, you demons. Your end is in sight. For Elijah Muhammad told us what that plane was to do and what death and destruction as well as life was carried on that plane. It's getting closer, Reagan. What you gonna do when it shows up over Washington? You can't shoot it out of the sky. You ain't got nothing. I understand why you want a Star Wars initiative. I know why you want to build a space station. You think that you will be able to get up there and do a little damage, you fool. You are just like the damn fools that fought against God in the past and thought they could win, but God never loses. And he didn't come here today to lose. That's why today he don't think 2 cents of you. He won't even whip you himself. He'll raise one from the ranks of those that you have destroyed. And then give him power and dominion and make him Christ and make him Lord and make him master. That's why I'm saying to you Muslims, you don't know the value of what you got. Some of you are worse than the Indians. You had something of value and you threw it away. Like the Indians sold Manhattan for trinkets. You sold your birthright. For what? A rendezvous with the dying crescent world of Islam. This is why Master Farad Muhammad, when he gave us a flag, he put it in the first, a crescent in the first quarter.
Yes.
And all the crescents of the Islamic world are in the final quarter. Because Prophet Muhammad was the last exponent of a religious system that is as old as God himself, but he closes out an old world.
Yes, it does.
And there's a man named Jesus. and Christ and a new Muhammad that is to come and usher in a brand new world order. But that order cannot come in until this one is destroyed and taken out of power. And the power to destroy it is already present. That's what I'm telling you. Your children that come here, they're not crazy. Your family members that come here, they're not crazy. And if I could sit down and talk with all of you gainsayers one-on-one, I don't care how much degree you have, you can't defeat what I have. All you can do is bear me witness. Because what you have of the truth kisses and embraces what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has taught us. So now, I'll end this subject. I'll begin what I really wanted to say and end it at the same time. Fear and dislike of yourself has caused us to reject God's man that came among us. He couldn't be the equal of any of the former prophets, yet he's dealing with a problem that none of the former prophets, including Prophet Muhammad, could handle. You are that problem, black man and woman. There never was a people at any time, any place on this earth that were in a worse condition than white power has rendered you in the time of the judgment of the world. And if the world were to be destroyed, you would be destroyed with the world because of your ignorance and your love of your enemies. You can't marshal the strength to stand and fight because you love the killer that is coming to kill you. And you love him in the name of Jesus when Jesus didn't love him himself. You are so deceived religiously that you can justify hating your husband, a man that gave you a baby, even if he didn't support the baby. He didn't do against you what the white man did against all of us, but you can justify loving white people and you teach your children against their own fathers. Don't you? Hate-filled women, except for the one you should hate. We know he's hate-filled by the way he treats you. We know he hates himself, but he hates himself because he's a fool. And he was turned a fool by the same enemy that killed Jesus. Amen. Now, I'll calm down a minute. You know what hurts me? Is because I know from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad what will benefit you. As it has benefited all of us. But you know, the truth can only benefit one who believes in it and practices it. My mother, my father, my sister, my brother, I love them. But if the truth is rejected, how can I benefit mom? How can I benefit my father? How can I benefit my friends? I grew up with friends that I love. When I became a Muslim, they said the nigga went crazy. He gave up his show business career. Like you think your children went crazy. Because we give up the world. We don't give up the world because we done got to be religious fanatics. We don't give up eating. We don't give up sleeping. We don't give up making babies. We don't give up trying to make a better life for ourselves. We give up the filth and the degenerate life of the world.
Yes, sir. That's
right. What's wrong with that? All my cousins, I have buried 9 or 10 of them. All of them died, alcoholics. But here their cousin don't drink. I've outlived my cousins and their children. And now I'm outliving their, my cousins' grandchildren, who are my third cousins. I'm outliving them. They dying now. Because their cousin had a knowledge that could have saved them from the bottle. But they didn't want to listen. You are putting in your stomach right now that which is killing you. You look at your children, they come here, and in a few weeks, you see a change in their expression in their faces. You say, well, what's happening to them? What are they doing to you down there? They're brainwashing you? Well, with all the filth, listen, that is being poured over the airwaves, over the television, that you don't mind spending your hours every day looking at the general hospital. And as the world turns and turning on your radio and getting funky, if you excuse the expression, to the latest funk tune, and you can fill your head with that, don't you think if you met Jesus, he would have to wash your head? Didn't he wash his disciples' feet? Don't you think the path that you are treading is a dirty path and your feet need to be washed? I think so. So brainwashing ain't bad if your brain is dirty. And you can't wash nobody's brain with soap. What do you think baptism is all about? Baptism ain't taking a man and woman up in the church and dunking them down in water. And they come up and you say, you know, I baptize you in the name of Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Boom, 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 boom. And then you pull them up and they change and they say, hallelujah, I'm changed. That's a lie. And you know it. You the same old Negro after baptism that you were before baptism. In fact, maybe you worse. And in your heart, you know I'm right. You know I'm right. All right. Baptism only means, as water rejuvenates the flesh, the wisdom and the Spirit of God rejuvenates the mind. And when you get the wisdom of God in your head, it will clean your thoughts. You begin to straighten out the way you think. Now, I'm going to conclude this subject. It'll take me about 15 minutes. And I'm going to introduce the study this week. I just want to read something from the Holy Quran. Y'all all right?
Yes, sir.
I am too. By the star when it sets, your companion errs not, nor does he deviate. This is talking about the death or the passing from the scene of a great star, a great mind, a great being. By the star when it sets. Listen. When the Honorable Elijah Muhammad moved from the scene, that was like the setting of a great star. After that star was gone, we couldn't get guidance from that star anymore unless we believe in the unseen. And the Quran opens those who believe in the unseen and keep up prayer. It is not what you see that is the power. It's the unseen reality behind the seen expression of that reality. That's the real power the unseen. We see the earth. We walk on the earth. But the power behind the earth, you can't even see. The earth just floats on in an orbit. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
What is the power that upholds the earth? You don't see that power. All you bask in is the power that's in the earth, but there's a power that upholds the earth that's bigger than the power that you get from the earth. You follow what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
If we believed in what Elijah Muhammad taught us when he left us, we would believe in the unseen even though it had not been made manifest. So the next verse says, your companion errs not. We walked with Muhammad. One of his sons said, my father is a great social reformer, but he made many mistakes. I say, your companion errs not. He didn't make a mistake. You made a mistake in not following him. That's the mistake. And ever since you made that mistake, your behind been tumbling into hell. All of you,
yes, sir,
that think he was a liar and that he made a mistake in what he taught us, what is your condition now and what was it then?
Yes,
if you are not in error now, why can't you back it up? The whole world was against us yesterday. But when he was here and we were solid with him, we overcame the world. Because greater was the power that was in us than the power that was in the world. But you are overcome by the world today. Drunkards and thieves and drug addicts and liars and whoremongers. All of this after the star set. Your companion errs not, nor does he deviate. It's just that we didn't understand. He didn't speak out of desire. It is naught but revelation that is revealed. One mighty in power has taught him. Not Sheikh Ben Bass of Mecca.
No, sir.
Sheikh Ben Bass don't know nothing about no mother plane. He blind on two ends. I'm not mocking him.
No, sir.
He's a great scholar, but he ain't great enough to deal with what this world needs to be dealt with.
Go ahead.
I know it's right, too. Who in America, who in the world was teaching about this unidentified flying objects 55 years ago? Nobody. But a man taught it and stuck by it, and here come now the revelation that it's real. And even if you think the man was mistaken, soon you're going to see him. Now what are you going to tell your children? That Santa Claus, he changed his reindeers? You can tell that kind of lie to your children in the name of Jesus. You should be ashamed of yourself. You should never lie. You should never tell your children this wicked thing that some fat white man or black man is bringing something down your chimney when you know it's you. Tell them the truth. And don't call it no little white lie done in the name of fun. Because when you deceive your children, they will one day grow up with that thought in their mind, and you have absolutely undermined their confidence in you as their parent. Don't do that. There is no lie worth the confidence of your children. Tell them the truth. And if you don't know the truth, be strong enough to say, sweetheart, I don't know, but I'll get the answer. Elijah Muhammad was right on it. And I'm only too sorry that so many of us, since he's been gone, have lost our lives, lost our minds, lost our way, all because we took him to be in error. And we find out now, later on, he was not in error. We were the ones in error to go away from him. And just as the Quran says, one day we will say, woe is me. And we will bite our fingers in intense regret, saying, would that I had taken away with the messenger. And would that this one that deceived me, the distance between him and me was the distance between the east and the west. I say you should get away from the liars and deceivers and fly to your God Allah and to his servant, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
And now as I conclude, my subject was supposed to have been the struggle for balance. And maybe that's the subject I needed today. We have a course of study here at the Final Call building, which you all are welcome to attend. A struggle for balance. It's really called self-improvement, the basis for community development. We're not going to be nothing as a people until we take on the challenge of improving ourselves. Listen, please. You can go to church, you can read the Bible, you can do all of that, but you are not too old to improve yourself. And the moment you stop thinking in terms of improving yourself, you are already dead. Because death puts an end to the evolutionary journey in your physical realm toward God. The struggle for balance. We have been an imbalanced people all our lives. It's not your fault, not mine, but we are imbalanced. 99% of us. And the other percent is even in worse shape. They don't even know it. But there's 100% imbalance among us as a people. Please listen. A doctorate degree doesn't give you balance. A lawyer's degree does not give you balance. Sister, your professional career does not give you balance. In fact, these things are what you think will give you balance, and they increase your imbalance. Women and their bad trials with men, and the hurt that they feel over our disrespect and mistreatment of them, drives them in another direction.
Yes,
well, I'm through with men. Or, I don't need a man. I'll go on and get for myself. And the more you get for yourself, sisters, you got a job, you got money, you got a bank account, you got a car, you got a home, you got a fur coat, you got diamond ring, you got all the things that you, your man never gave you. You gave it to yourself, but you ain't happy. Because your happiness was not meant to be in those things that you thought he could provide you with, that he failed to provide you with, that made you get rid of him. And you're still now single and unhappy. And out of balance. In other words, nuts. Wait. Did I say anything wrong? Wait. I know you don't think you're crazy. I know. But if they were to put everybody that's imbalanced in the insane asylum, America and the world would be one giant cage. Some of us in less badder shape than others. But if you watch our walk, listen to our talk, see our actions, we are imbalanced. Now follow what I'm saying. This is critical because I want you to go home with this thought in mind. And I want you to go home with this thought in mind that God has really blessed us with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And whether he's present or absent, we need to reflect on what the man taught. We need to know what the man taught, because in what he taught is our deliverance. Now look, as I send you out from this place today, I would love that you, along with me, go home and think about balance. Did you know that the earth is oblong, right?
Yes, sir.
Is it?
Yes, sir.
If it's oblong and not perfectly round, it doesn't have a smooth motion. There's a wobble in the motion of the earth. Right through the earth is what is called an axis. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And that axis is on an incline. And that incline is 23 degrees, 30 minutes to the plane of the earth's orbit. Now that don't make too much sense to anybody, but hang in there with me, will you? Now, anytime something wobbles, it has a crooked path. You ever been in your car and the tire is imbalanced?
Yeah.
Is it a smooth ride?
No, sir.
It isn't?
No, sir.
How does it make you feel after you've been riding for 1 hour in a car where there's a wobble in the tire? You were so glad when that ride stopped, you get out. You don't want to walk, but I mean, good God, that wasn't a comfortable ride either, was it? But there's a wobble in the earth, but you don't feel nothing. And the earth is moving at the speed of 1,037 and one-third miles per hour on its way around the sun, and you don't even know you're moving. Isn't that a smooth ride?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
God is something, ain't he?
Yeah.
Isn't it wonderful?
Yeah.
You came up out of the earth and didn't know you was moving. You walk on the earth, go to work every day, don't even realize you're spinning at that terrific speed. You don't feel nothing because God has compensated for the wobble and the imbalance. He's brought up mountains in the earth. The Quran says that the earth would not convulse with you like you put weights on a tire. See, just balance. And the balance is so exquisite till you can't even feel motion. That means less little or no friction. Of course, we know there is some friction because it's not a perfect motion. Now, what does this tell us? What are we learning from this? That the earth is perfectly balanced. Did you come up out of the earth? Who called you up out of the earth? God did. The same God that has given balance to this, where you live your, have your movement with little or no friction, that same God wishes to give us a life where there's very little or no friction, that as we move in life, we meet each other and there's not friction between us because there's justice and balance in our actions. Therefore, we are an exquisite creation moving through life just like the planets, exquisitely balanced. But that's not the case, is it? I bump into you. You bump into me. We bump into each other. As brothers and sisters, we fight each other. We hurt each other. We kill each other. Look at the races and how they relate to each other. No balance. What happened? What happened? Here it is in a nutshell. As the earth is on an incline, that's to tell us that there are certain natural inclinations in us as human beings. You are a woman, we are men. Are we naturally inclined to each other? Anything different is not natural.
I know some of you say, oh no, I'm a man inside this female body. I just have a problem. Nobody understands me. Or I'm a woman inside this male body, I'm trapped. So because I'm a woman in a man's body, I incline to men. But that inclination is something that was made. The God of nature don't make mistakes. He don't give you a physical body of a male. And he didn't give you the spiritual capacity of the man and the leanings of the man. That's wrong. Because you can't have a baby, can you? You may want to be a woman, but you can't do that thing, can you? No, you can't grow no breasts, can you? Oh yeah, I know what you do. You take you some hormones and you grow some breasts, but you can't put no baby on it. That baby come away totally disenchanted. So God didn't make no mistake. You're a man. And you're a woman. And the natures of you both is complementary by God's creative plan to one another. And we find fulfillment as we naturally incline toward one another. Now there's a time in your life as a girl and in our life as young boys, we ain't thinking about girls. I mean, we started kind of early. And he's starting earlier all the time. But there is a time when you don't think about boys. Is that right? You like to be with other little girls. Is that true? You soon outgrow that, don't you? Likewise. Now, as we outgrow these things, we start following what? Our inclination. I'm inclined to the woman, therefore I got to find me one to fulfill life. I'm inclined to the man, sister talking, therefore I must find a man to fulfill my life. Very good. But that's a secondary inclination. And no matter how much you incline to the man and incline to the woman, when you find that woman that you've been looking for, and you find a man that you've been looking for, it affects you tremendously, doesn't it? Have you ever been affected like that? May have been a long time ago, but let's go back and think about it. Let's go back now in time. Just a minute. You younger ones, if you've been hit by the what they call the thunderbolt of love, you know what I mean? And you just got... You're just in love. Love turns you on from the inside. Listen to me. You don't look the same. It's true. An old tired look. All of a sudden you get life from somewhere. And people begin noticing you. Oh, you look so different. They say, well, what is it? Well, you don't know how to answer this. I don't know. Maybe it's my diet. Maybe you know what it is. It's that man. Is that right? And she has an effect on you, brother. She's in your mind, you know? He's in your mind. You're supposed to be on your job concentrating. Here he come. Pow. They see you on the job with your foot on the pedal of the machine. Seamstress and machine ain't going, you know what I mean? Or it's going, but you ain't with it. You sewed up the wrong side of the material. And the foreman said, what's the matter with you, girl? I'm just in love. And that's serious. And love is powerful. It affects you. When you love somebody like that, don't you call them? As fast as you get to the phone. Hi, honey. they call you? You get so much joy out of each other's company? But what is it about this thing called love that got you so hooked up now? It's because that person satisfied a need in you. You needed something, that's the person that filled it. And because they fulfilled the need, that just makes the love in you just grow. But I said it's a secondary inclination. After a while, something happens. As it did happen, didn't it? Didn't it happen? Your little bubble got busted, right? What happened to that beautiful love affair? It's gone. And left you broke up, tore down, beat up. Now people look at you and say, we know what happened. Say, why are you looking like that? I fell out of love. Now, you know why you fell out of love? Many reasons, but one of the main reasons is there was no balance in the relationship. You see, we have a need in us that only God can fill that void. I'm talking about the first inclination. Now, I want you to follow me carefully because this is the most important point I'm going to say today. But if you have not found God, didn't even know you needed him, then you take the love of the man and the love of the woman and you put them in the place of God. That's how you can sing these crazy songs. I love you, baby. And if you leave me, I sure would die. I mean, that's heavy stuff there, brother. Say, when you left me, baby, the sun just wouldn't shine. I mean, now that's heavy, brother. That's why they call them blues, you know what I mean? And you're all messed up because you took a secondary inclination, made it the primary inclination, and then lost your balance in that relationship. Are you listening to me? Please, wait. Just give me a couple more minutes, all right? And you can explode if you want it with applause, but I really want you to listen to this. Okay. Now, I was in show business, okay? I guess you could tell. Hey, nigga, when did you leave? Oh, the minister had to get... I had to get that first part off, you know? It was weighing heavy on me. This is the truth. I came here with a beautiful subject for you, but that first part was so heavy I had to get it off because I'm really pained to see how we rejected the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and still do. And every day more and more truth is coming out to show how right on the man was. And all I'm suggesting to us is it's okay if you're alive. Let's come back to that man and what he taught. And I mean your life will change for the better. That's all I'm saying there. But with this balance thing, which is very, very important, I was in show business, and I have a very tough mother, you know, bless her heart. She's a great black woman. I mean, she's real dark, real beautiful. And I mean, that's the cause of my love for black people. That black woman drilled it into me to love black people. And if she saw me inclining the other way, she would bust that inclination up. She put the violin in my hands at 5 years old, and she went without stockings to give my brother and I music lessons. She sacrificed for us. And
But she was a strange kind of mama. I didn't understand at all. I was scared of her. Because she was so highly intelligent. With no father around. She was so heavy till no man could handle her. I can understand. And I feel sorry for so many of you, sisters. You're so far ahead of men. Till they just can't give you no kind of comfort on this level. And it makes it so painful in life. Well, my mother was like that. I mean, she could take a dime and milk a dime and make a dime grow to a dollar while a man was looking at a dollar fall to a dime. This woman
is something.
This woman was so frugal and so intelligent. She would leave her house and could come back in later and find out that somebody else was in her house. She said, well, son, did you have somebody in here while I was gone? Oh, no, Ma, no, no. Then she smacked me. Ma! I want the truth, boy. Well, yes, Ma. How did she know? She knew where everything was. And if it moved a hair from the way she had it, she knew somebody moved it. She was so meticulous about everything. You couldn't go to our drawers today. When I say our drawers, I mean our dresser drawers. Please. 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 Please now. And you know what's in all your drawers. But that woman knew what was in this drawer, what was in that drawer. I don't care if it's 100 things in there. She knew exactly where everything was. She was very orderly, in other words. She was not a confused person. Now look, but she was strange. I'd go play the violin. My brother played the piano. The people just break up. I mean, tear the house up. She's just sitting there with her hands full. I'm looking at her, you know. People going crazy, Mom ain't saying nothing. So I said, this is strange, you know what I mean? Maybe we didn't do too good, Alvin. When we get home, Mom would say, you did well. But I heard a few mistakes, so you go and practice some more, you know? She was always, she didn't know music. She couldn't read nothing. But every time we made a boo-boo, she heard it, brother. Now, I'm saying that to say something else. My mother did not give me, you know what children like? They like their parents to praise them. Oh, you're beautiful. You're wonderful. Take time and wrestle with you and hug. She was too busy scrubbing white folks' floors, being on that machine, sewing, making money. She ain't had time to hug me and give me all that kind of thing that normal parents give normal children, you understand? So I didn't think the woman, you know, loved me. But I could never go to my drawer and open my dresser drawer and not find underwear there. Clean and ironed. Shirts there. Clean and ironed. Socks there. Look here now. I ain't never slept on a dirty bed. Don't know what a dirty bed looks like. Don't know what a dirty home looks like. Except I went in somebody else's house, but not in mine. That woman was clean to the core, man. Do you hear me? I never knew what it was to go to bed hungry, though that woman might only have a quarter in her pocket. She knew how to make nothing and turn it into something so that our bellies could be full, so I didn't know no hunger pain. She showed love in a way that as I grew older, I would understand it, and thank God she's still alive where I can tell her. But many of you have grown closer to your parents in death because you understand them more as you live more of life. Now look at this. When I ran track, I was an excellent dash man. And my mother never came to see me run. You understand this, man? I'm running, I'm breaking records, equaling records. City champ, this and that and the other. She ain't there. My brother's state champ in the hurdles and the high jump. She ain't there. She ain't interested in no sport. Well, she must have been following the Quran, you know? Before we knew what the Quran was, because this Quran don't give nothing for sport and play. So when I began to play and sing, this was the thing that gave me gratification. Because I wanted to be something in life, don't you?
Yes, sir.
How do you know that you're growing to be something in life? It's when people acknowledge what you do. So if you're a seamstress, if you're a beautiful woman and you win a beauty contest, all the little things that make people notice you and you stand out, these are the things that give you what they call self-worth. Don't you want to be worth something? I do. But here's the imbalance. This planet is inclined 23 degrees, 30 minutes to the plane of its orbit. So it has a very special path that the Earth follows, that Mercury does not follow, no other planet follows. So do you have a very special gift that God gave you. And you will incline to the path of your gift. Do you follow me? If it's basketball, in order to be a great basketball player, what must you do? Right. If you're going to be a boxer, if you're going to be a chemist, if whatever you're going to be, whatever your discipline is, if that's the inclination that God has given you, then the only way you can be great in it is you got to do what? Sacrifice and give it time and hard work so that you can become a master of your own inclination. Now, here's what happens. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, great basketball player. Muhammad Ali, great boxer. Whitney Houston, was that girl Janet Jackson? Anita Baker, beautiful songstresses. Some of our brothers and sisters in mathematics and chemistry and business and whatnot. If this is what makes you feel that you are somebody, then you incline to that, but then you get out of balance. Because I got out of balance as a musician. My wife sits here. I worked on my music 8 and 10 hours a day. And I would go in a room and shut the door. And she would not disturb me because I didn't want to be disturbed. I come out when I want to eat. Now you say the man's nuts. Well, I'm one of the 30 million. I said we all was crazy in one way or another. That's an imbalance. My wife is there. She has needs. Do you care? Really, no. You say you do, but deep down inside, you don't care. And you know how you excuse yourself? You say, honey, the more I work at this, you'll be able to have all the nice things in life. But the real reason is, the more I work at this, the more I'll be somebody. And it means more to me to be somebody than to be something to somebody else. That's imbalance. That's madness. Do you hear me, brothers?
Yes, sir.
Every one of us that want to be something in life, we put our time where we love. And we love our job, we love our discipline, we love whatever we love. That's where we put our time. If it's law, sister, if it's medicine, whatever it is that you love, that's where you put your time because that's what makes you somebody, regardless to your being married to a man or his being married to you. And that's why we got all this imbalance, because there's too much selfishness. I'm concluding. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, when I met him, he told me, not the first time I met him, but as he and became acquainted with me and a gift that I had, the gift of speech, which I didn't know I had. He saw in that gift of speech a value to reach his people. But I also needed balance. I have children, 9 of them, that didn't have a father. Why didn't my children have a father? They have a father. What is this, True Confessions, Farrakhan? No. It's a struggle for balance. And I don't care how good I look in your eyes. See, truth humbles us all and makes us see ourselves as we really are. And I'm using myself as an example to give you courage to face the imbalance of yourself so that you can leave here and struggle for balance so you can have a better life. And all your surroundings will be better when you and I are much more balanced. Do you follow what I'm saying? Now, my children, they had food. I mean, we ate beans for about 9 years. This is true. This is true. Never had hardly any money. I was a hard-working minister for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, but I was poor as a bowl of Yakima. Whatever that is. I was so poor that Sister Clara Muhammad, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's wife, came to Boston and saw my wife's and my condition, and she broke down and cried, but I didn't even know I was poor. She was crying over our poverty, but I was in such good spirit that I didn't know I was poor. I gave up a career at that time that would have netted me at that time $500 a week 32 years ago. And going toward the $1,000 and $1,500 a week mark. I gave that up to work for $40 a week for my faith. People thought I was a fool, but I didn't know where my faith was going to take me. I'm talking about faith in God. I was imbalanced. Yes, it's true. My wife and I suffered. True. The children suffered. It's true. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad told me that Master Farad Muhammad, his teacher, told him, don't worry about your children. Allah will take care of them. He told me, don't worry about your family, brother. Go after our poor people because the judgment of this world is coming down fast. And if somebody don't go after them, they will be killed and won't even know why they're dying. You're dying right now and don't know why you're dying. But America is falling and she's not going to tell you the truth. She's intend to carry us with her. So I made a conscious sacrifice. And I hope that one day my children will understand. My mother made a sacrifice. She sacrificed no good men in her life that she could give my brother and I a life. We ain't never seen no man in our house sleeping in our mother's bed. And she's a natural woman like any other woman, but I ain't never seen it in my house. She sacrificed all of that for me and my brother. So I see that I was born into the world from a sacrificing mother to give my life for the black man's rise. And I make no apologies for that. I'm born to die for you. That's what makes Jesus real to me. Because I don't talk this. I live it every day of my life. You ain't on Front Street. The white man ain't after you. The government ain't after you. They after me because what I got in my mouth from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad will wake you up overnight. My wife may never be happy as a woman should be happy under normal circumstances. A man should be able to go home, sit with his family, and talk about problems. Under normal circumstances, a man should be able to do that. But as a young boy, I took the mission of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad serious, and I had no qualifications. All I had was love in my heart for black people, man. And people try to burn my house down, kill my wife and my family.
Yes, sir.
I didn't know what I was getting into, but I'm in it now.
Yes, sir.
And ain't no turning back.
That's right.
And if I lost all my family, I would keep on going.
Yes, sir.
Even though it would grieve me, I can't bow down to them and their need when I see a whole people going to hell. I got to get after you. You the one that have to be raised. And if they will understand that tomorrow may be brighter because somebody was willing to die today,
yes, sir.
Then my living and my death will not be in vain.
Yes, sir.
But what the hell good is it if I come home every night and see our people go to hell living in this wicked and rotten condition? How will that benefit my children and my grandchildren when they got to grow up and play with dope addicts and become one themselves? So if we don't work to reform the world's wickedness will destroy all the good that we try to do. You agree with me? All right. So when I was in physics, I learned about a lever. And if you put a weight on this lever, and that's 150 pounds, and you put a weight on this side, and it's 50 pounds, you can't put the center of gravity there, because if you do, this will go this way. Is that right?
That's right.
Because this outweighs this.
That's right.
You got the picture?
Yes, sir.
So the fulcrum, which this is called, if you want to balance the lever, you got to move it more towards here. And if you take a ratio, this is to this, as this is to this, you find out exactly where the fulcrum should be put so that there's perfect balance. Well, I didn't have no mathematics. I just went to work. And I found that in giving life to our people, it compensated. My soul was satisfied because I was doing what I was born to do. I'm inclined 23 degrees, 30 minutes to the plane of the orbit of sacrifice of my life. So just like it pleases some of you to fight, it pleases me to live and die for black people. That's my thing. I don't deserve no credit, just like you don't deserve no credit. If you born to play the piano and you do it well, then go on and do your thing. But my thing is living and dying for black people. That's my thing. That's what I'm born into the world to do. And that's what I shall do. And there is nothing and no one that can take me away from that commitment. That's clear. So God put the fulcrum there. And God supplied the balance because I didn't. And so my family, my wife, and my children are still with me, bruised, bent, but loving that man because they know he wasn't out there drinking and partying. He wasn't out there gambling and throwing away his money. He was dealing for black people. But now that I'm sensitive to balance, I must struggle to put more balance in my life. And you know how you get balance? When you make God first in your life. Not your girlfriend, not your boyfriend, not your husband, not your husband, not your husband, not your wife, but Almighty God Allah. That's my concluding point. If you can call on your girlfriend and feel good about loving her, and call on your boyfriend and feel good about loving him, and call him all times of the day and night because you just want to talk to him and be close to him, and that boyfriend didn't give you the inclination, that boyfriend or girlfriend, that husband, that wife, that mother, that father, that friend, that teacher, they were not with you in the womb when you were being formed. Even though your mother was the vessel through which you were brought, she didn't even know she was pregnant with you until time made her see it. But there was a powerful God in the womb forming you, and it didn't have no help. Look at this now. When you come forth out of your mother's womb, and I came forward, it wasn't my girlfriend there. It wasn't my wife there. My son wasn't there, and you weren't there. Yes, but a powerful God, a beneficent God, put milk in my mother's breast for me. And I went to that breast, and I didn't find it empty. And a bond grew between me and my mother through her breast and my coming there regularly to feed. She was bonded to me and I to her, like your baby is bonded to you and you to your baby through the act of breastfeeding. You all ought to do that. And take your baby off this damn formula, this white man, and put him on the formula that God gives you. Yeah, stop making excuses. Well, I work. Squeeze it in a bottle. Till you get home. Oh, nigga, stay off of me. Leave me alone. I'm doing what I want to do. One of these days, I want to teach you, if you get allow me to, why there's more value in your breasts than in all the cows that God made. And all the chemical formulas. Even if you are a sick mother, your milk is better for your baby than the most sanitary cow's milk that they can find. You kicking the calves away from the cow so you can put your baby that ain't no animal on a damn animal so you think you can have pretty form? Woman, you a crazy woman. You losing your form by not following nature. You carrying all these damn diseases, female disorders, because you violate nature. And you die young because you violate nature. You die young physically, but you die from the ovary point of view where you can't have no more babies. Because you're killing yourself following this white man who is death itself. His wicked way of civilization. When I and you were able to grow, we went to the tree and we saw an orange on the tree. If you're living in the South or in the Caribbean, in your yard there were grapes and pomegranates and avocados and oranges and lemon and lime, a beneficent God feeding you. And a beneficent God created a need in you and then created a man to fulfill that need and a woman to fulfill your need and mine, and then we take what he created and put that above the creator. That's why there ain't no balance. You don't pray. We don't pray enough. You call him 5 times a day, but you can't call on God till you get in trouble. That's why there's no balance in your life, because God is not real until you get in trouble. Then we know how to call him and make our prayers sincere. We got to turn this around. If you really want balance, come back to God. If you really want balance, make God number one, because whether you know it or not, you were born into this world inclined toward him first. Since he was with you first in the womb. And when you came out of the womb, you didn't say, "Mama." You look at the baby when it cries, it goes like this. And you see the tongue go up, and come back down. It's in Allah. That's the first one you call on. Then later they learn "Mama" and "Daddy." But the cry, watch the tongue. You say, "Allah, Allah." Oh, you watch that baby and he cry. In everything there's a sign. Allah is the proper name of God, not God. God only means force and power. There are many gods. Who is the God that created the heavens and the earth? His proper name is Allah. And if you call on him by his name, you will be saved. You got 1 billion black people on this earth, white, red, yellow, and brown, that call on Allah. And all of us call on him one way or another before you learn whatever language you learn the name of the deity in. So, beloved brothers and sisters, I'm going to strive for more balance in my life. Not that I'm going to be less sacrificial, but sacrifice in the way of God cannot be for vain purpose. That's what I'm saying. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Study and application and absence from your house and your family cannot be for vain purposes. We don't travel the world for vain purposes. We travel in search for the wisdom of God to do more of God's will. But there's a duty that each of us have to our wives, our husbands, our children, and it's that duty and the doing of it that gives us balance. God is primary. We are secondary. But if you do the primary duty well and establish a good relationship with your Creator, then all other relationships fall in line with proper balance. And you will never again say to a man that you adore him and without him you can't go on. Ain't no man that strong but God. Without him you can't go on. Without your husband you'll go on. And if you doubt it, if he die, you don't go with him. You take him out of the bed that he used to sleep in. You don't sleep in the bed with him. You get the hell out of that bed till the undertaker come and get him out. And you may not even go back in the room till the scent or everything of death is out of there. Shoot. You sleep with him as long as he's alive. But when death come, you say, "Come get him." And I don't care how pretty she is, brother. Fine she is. Long as she's alive, she's really fine. But when she's dead, pretty legs and all. Skinny legs and all. The undertaker can come and get legs and all. So don't get carried away with each other. Because we are finite, God is infinite, therefore we must strike the right relationship with him, get a balanced relationship with everything else, God himself is the balance. He supplies the balance. Let's struggle and get balance in our lives. So when you leave here today, let's get our families together.
Yes, sir.
Muslim and Christian, agnostic, nationalist, pan-Africanist, sit down as a family. Break bread together. Don't argue, discuss. Discuss the things where you might differ, because you don't differ that much. When you get away all the extraneous stuff, you find out that we're very close. You believe in Jesus? We do too. You believe that there's but one God? We believe in him too. You believe that nobody can do evil forever and get away with it? We do too. But we believe that white folks have done evil for a long time and their day of judgment has come. You've done evil and I've done evil myself. But God forgives us if we submit to him because we have never had a divine guide from God, but we have guidance from within ourselves that's from him that make you to know when you're wrong. But now you got a guide direct from God to get you out of this condition. And if you don't hearken to his voice, then the same punishment that the wicked will get for all the evil that they've done, it will fall on our heads also. We believe that this world is finished and we have to build a new world. And we believe that you and I are the lost sheep of the Bible, the lost people, the prodigal son. We are the dead that God would raise up from death, not the cemetery, but black folk, dead mentally, morally, spiritually, socially, politically, economically, and otherwise. We're just in a powerless condition. God wants to restore us and restore us to balance, to sanity, to justice. So in the book of Revelations, you see a man riding a black horse. And the man that was on that black horse in the four horses of the apocalypse, he had the scale in his hand.
Yes, sir.
God wants to give you the measure, the criterion, the standard by which you can be just and equitable in all our dealings one with another. So will you practice that?
Yes,
if I don't see you again, practice justice. Practice it. Do to others, not before they do to you. Do to others as you would have others do unto yourself. Practice that. You don't want nobody to rob you? Don't rob anybody else. You don't want nobody to come in your house and take your wife and your daughter and abuse them? Don't go in your brother's house taking his wife or his daughter. Respect yourself and be equitable in your dealings. Don't cheat. No man give every man their due, but you can't do that unless you give God his first. Take no partner with God as an object of worship, lest you throw yourself into total imbalance, insanity. And that's why the world is totally messed up. It is guilty of polytheism, shirk, and disbelief in God. Thank you so much for a wonderful afternoon. Thank you for putting up with the fire of this lecture and the spirit of it. I hope you were able to get something from it. Every mother, every father, every family member of a Muslim that came today, I don't want you to stay away from us. I want you to become more knowledgeable of what your children have become a part of, not so you can join it, but so you can understand it. So when the enemy starts dropping his foolishness, you can defend your child. We don't teach your children here to do one thing against God or man. Remember that. Not one of these do we tell to rob, to steal, to lie, to cheat, to do drugs, to fornicate, to commit adultery, or to do anything against the law of God or man. Anything that they do, that's the weight that they have to walk with, because that's what they wanted to do, not what they're being taught.
So you help to correct them if you see them out of the way. And they, as your children, love you and want you to understand them and what they've become a part of. So I hope at least it's a little clearer than it was before. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you for listening. As I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Let's hear it one more time for Brother Minister Farrakhan.